Hi everyone, thanks for joining our online webinar. Please write a plus in the chat window if you hear me well. Good. Thanks. Today we are learning about Microsoft Azure Service Fabric from Denis Latushkin. My name is Christina and I'm the moderator of this event. The webinar will last around 1 hour and 30 minutes, and there will be a recording available for you in our LinkedIn group. I will share with you the link to this page in our chat window. Also, I suggest everyone to go on mute to eliminate extra noise during the webinar. But if you have any questions to the speaker, just write them in the chat and Denis will answer them during the presentation. The organizers of this event are InventorSoft Group, and let me introduce you our CTO, Maxim Rushkevich.
Hi to everyone, and thanks for accepting our invitation for this webinar. A couple of words about our company. InventorSoft is a software development company specializing in building web and mobile applications using technologies. We work at various projects and by different models, and one of which is SFOX model, where we build remote development teams in Ukraine for the Nordic product companies. It's already our second webinar this year, and I wish you have a nice one today.
Thank you. As Maxim mentioned, it's our second webinar. Last time we spoke about building microservices using Java and Spring Boot. So if you're interested to learn about that, feel free to join our group on LinkedIn. Today's speaker, Denis Latushkin, is a software developer and architect with over 20 years of practical experience and constant learning in IT. Advanced problem solver, fan of elegant architecture and clean code, as our teammates call him. Denis has a solid expertise in .NET framework, Azure, and Azure services. In the current project, Denis and his team, some of the team members are present in our webinar today, had to dive deep into the Azure service fabric, faces challenges, and come up with their insights and discoveries. And now, Denis, are you ready to start?
Yes, thank you for introduction. So today we are going to talk about Service Fabric. I am not a fan of theory. I would like to mix it with practice, maybe more practice, less theory. And we are going to see some easy but working project related to our domain model. To our domain is railway, trains on railway, all kind of gadgets, all kind of integrations, and that's it. In this webinar, I'm not going to share production code because, first of all, it's too complex to review it in this short time. From other side, we want to illustrate theory, so just simple project. So starting from theory, what is Service Fabric? It's solution from Microsoft for some cluster applications, some applications that can work on in multiple nodes clusters. So and actually, all the things may be done manually if you want, but we would like to have some solid proven solution that will do at least routines for us, and we can just concentrate on the main model. So actually, why we choose it? It's curiosity, because all the team, we want something new, because we wrote a lot of this classical systems when we have kind of some web app, some service, some database, and the only maybe the most parallel project we do is just install few nodes with web service and some load balancing. So we want to get deeper into this cluster world. From other side, it's buzzword, so now everyone likes clusters, like parallel computation and so on, and actually it can be sold very well and practical experience is maybe exchanged with good money rate, hourly rate. And also we want this we want to have multiple microservices, of course, and we want some proven way to maintain all these microservices. We don't have few separate teams when each team is responsible for one or many microservices, this team and only this team. We have quite small team, and we want to do deployment of everything in one kind of in one package. So we choose this. So a little theories, programming model. Actually, as developer, you just create Visual Studio solution. We use Visual Studio 19 for this purpose, and all your microservices are there. Execution model is about how this microservices is executed. Actually, they are just console applications with special wrapper. So this allow these microservices to be discovered by some central point. From other side, it is understandable model for classical operation system, and we have quite easy deployment model when all our services is deployed in one pipeline, built in one solution, and deployed in one pipeline process. And by the way, we have a lot of benefits like health check, like incremental node upgrades, and so on. So let's start from creating solution for this project. I already started a little bit. So to create cluster, we just need a special wizard from Visual Studio. It is actually built in. So create something like this. New projects. Choose Fabric, and that's it. Choose the name. I have created. So how solution looks? First and main project here is Fabric project. I named Webinar Fabric. Here you have description of all microservices that in this cluster and all configuration here. So we have central project here and web API service. So let's talk a little bit about services. Let me switch to microservice types. We can create a few microservice types, and we can distinguish them or classify them by state model. One of the features of Service Fabric is stateful service model. Stateful means that you can run only one microservice of this type in a single moment of time. From other side, you may have replicas of the service. So for example, you have three node Service Fabric cluster, and you have at least three replicas of your stateful application. But in one moment of time, only one instance is active and is recognized by balancer as active. So all queries are sent only to single microservice in one moment of time. So let's choose it on practice. First of all, and this is first, RESTful and stateful and stateless. Stateless have no inner state, so it may be up to count of nodes microservice active and the load balancer will distribute queries between them according to set of parameters. Maybe the most simple is just kind of round robin. If you have the same virtual machines, its query will just be distributed by round robin 1, 2, 3, and then 1, 2, 3, and so on. From other side, depending on resource consumption on each virtual machine, queries can be distributed differently. Also, we may have two types of at least two types that we use in practice, two types of frameworks for your services. First of all, it's of course NetCore, according to nowadays. Also, you can create Net classical Net framework applications. Actually, it may look obsolete, but from other side, it is good help, a good boost when you need to communicate with some maybe obsolete or not NetCore friendly systems. For example, we on practice use this project to communicate with IBM WebSphere. We get some data about train movement from queue in IBM WebSphere. So actually, this ability will save our lives in this project. So this is two classification. Also, services have some need to communicate somehow between each other. So I think it's maybe one of the most benefits of Service Fabric that we have kind of isolated cluster, and we have communication remoting protocol. Maybe developers who worked for 10 years or more remember that it was remoting was protocol of communication in inter-process communication in NetVault in that time, and then it was kind of forgotten, and everybody started using HTTP queues and so on. But personally, I consider remoting protocol very handy model. It is we have types there. We have actually very very good, very easy model, and we even don't think about how this RPC works. We just have client needed service is discovered, and you just work with it. Reliable collections is for stateful services, and from one side it's a very powerful feature. From other side, it is very, very dangerous because it may consume your days, nights, and weeks, and so on. So what does it mean? Reliable collection is next step. Next generation of collections. It is preserved on disk its state, and when, for example, your stateful service need to go down, or maybe it's some error, maybe it's maintenance of your node or something else that turns off your stateful service, reliable collection is preserved on disk in many places, not on one disk. It is replicated, and when another instance of your stateful service started on another node, it is have all this state dictionaries and queues from the very beginning. So it's maybe kind of memory dump, for example. From other side, it is quite fast because you work with this collections like with regular dictionary without, for example, regular dictionary without any interprocess communication, without network communication. You have in process dictionary and the flow of serializing this is hidden from developer in theory. So you just don't care about anything. But but it's very dangerous because in it is a lot of problems with modification of schema of these collections. I will talk later. Actually, if you are not familiar with this subject, you should act very, very carefully. In other case, you will have this days and nights just to just in attempts to not to lose your data on in production. Also, what is very good, we have local debug, so you can install SDK of a service fabric on your machine and do everything locally. Yes, also I will talk about what dependency injection is used, and maybe if you have some additional time about login and application insights. Remember that you have multiple instances of your services, so classical login is not an option because it is quite hard to iterate through your, for example, three machines and find the needed records in local logs there. So okay, let's do a little practice. First of all, we need some domain model to do anything, I created some really simple but understandable and actually easy to program model. So imagine that we have some line on railway, and we have three trains there. Line have some lengths, for example, 100 kilometers. We have three stations here: Oslo, Paradise, and Stavanger. We have and trains just go back and forth, so it's kind of ring. So one train reach end of the track, it starts from the point, but in reverse direction. And we have two integrations. We can connect to system that sends topology to us. Topology, I mean, line and what stations are located there. And another system. Station has, for example, start point and an end point. And from another point of view, we have another integration. It's, let's talk, GPS position service. So some service pushing GPS data of each vehicle, of each wagon to our system. And what we want to get, we want to show to our customer what train is on what station now. Has station some trains, or it is free, or it is busy, and with what train it is equipped right now. So let me start my emulator. Yep, so.
Dennis, I just wanted to point attention that we have already some question in the chat. So if you have time.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I have. In PowerPoint, in domain model emulator and in actually and actually in Visual Studio itself. Yeah, so our trains is moving here. It's kind of our domain model. How are we going to solve this? we are going to have the next. We are going to have the following microservice structure. We want to have four services. Topology service. It is stateful. It expose remote listener. Periodically pulls topology service, topology integration, and just refresh topology state. Next, this service don't use reliable collections. Then we have GPS position service. It's stateful. It expose remote listener, and it's receives GPS data through WebAPI service, because WebAPI service is the only service that is accessible outside. So we have HTTP endpoint here, and the service just push by remoting protocol data to GPS position service. Also, we have train service that is stateless, and it calculates what train is in what station in current moment. So our little HTML application just pulls state of stations, pulls state of trains of station, and illustrated graphically. So let's create all the services. Yeah, webinar fabric. We want to add, by the way, how to add service here. We go to service fabric, add new fabric service. As I described before, we have stateless stateful service. We have ASP.NET Core stateless stateful. Also, we have kind of actor service. We are not going to talk today, and some Docker image services. So what we need next? We need stateful service, topology service. Yes, let's create. One moment. Also, we need one more stateful service that we call GPS position service. And also, we need one moment, not here. Also, we need stateless service, train service. Yeah, so now we have all the three services. And next step, we want to communicate, to give ability to communicate all the services between each other. We need additional project. Let's call it we need net standard. Yeah, kind of service interfaces. Yeah, here we want actually we want three services. We want three interfaces, because we don't need interface to WebAPI. And so actually, one moment, we need GPS position service. Yeah, actually, I will copy paste a little bit, because I think we will be out of time. So why do we need this interface? It is actually, it describes our service and what operations can be done with it. We need iService interface for such kind of interfaces. And when it iService, it is recognized as It is recognized as service interface. Also, we need a project with models. It is NetStandard class library as well. So let's call it cluster models. Yeah. And here we need actually a few models. One moment. First of all, we need to have lines. It's for topology. I want to make this model to be known to each service and cluster. It will, so it is easy to communicate between services. Actually, inside your classes, inside your services, you may have some private nested classes that is used only in the services. But from other side, something that is common, we can use in this way. Okay, so let me copy models we need. One moment. Yeah, so now we have all needed models, and now we can work with interfaces. So I think we should copy them as well, because we lost half an hour and we have only 40 minutes in reserve. So let's do it much a little bit faster. Yeah, let's leave this class. So we don't need it. So this is interfaces that let's add dependency here. We need cluster models. One moment. Yeah, this is interface for all three our service. Now we should add those interfaces to our services and add the universal client that we will inject in all in each our service and will use there. So each service will have a simple proxy to all other services. Okay, let's start from topology service. It is stateful service. Also, we need here, let's add reference to our models and to our interfaces actually. Yep. Yes, and we need to implement it. Because we don't want to do all this legwork with endpoints, with run async, with dependency injection, I would propose to create one basic class for all our stateful services and just inherit from it. So we will do everything much faster. So we have inherited from stateful service, which is a native class of Microsoft Service Fabric. But we need kind of our base webinar service that will do the same. will do all boring things instead of us. So, okay. We want additional project here. Let's name it service common. Oh, one moment. Just net standard project. Yep, and let's copy information there. Yes, let's get rid of this class. Service common contains basic service running. I will explain what is it when we will look at the program file. It has base stateful server with boring things in it. It has a remote services interface, which is for our interfaces, interfaces to another services, and it is injected for each service. We have iService event source, special interface for our event sources. I have item source for getting current date. And I have implementation of these remote services. I need to add reference here. Service interfaces, of course. Yes, and okay, since we have problem with dependency, yeah. Okay, let's update. Yeah, one moment. The problem is that service fabric was upgraded maybe few days ago, so we have major update. We have 4 version instead of 3 family version, and they have some problems with versioning. But actually, we should point to exact version, and we will have no problem in this case. So let's go to topology service. We need to upgrade it to the latest version. Yeah, to have this one. Okay, we just upgraded it. Let's inherit this service from our, first of all, we had reference to it. Our base stateful service. And once we did it, we will get rid of all this legwork. So base stateful service here. Now we can get rid of this function, of this method. Not from this one. We will change it to write implementation. Yes, so as I described before, topology service pulls integration of topology each, in our case, would be 10 seconds. Also, we want to have logic here. We don't want to have everything in our service. In real world, it should be just a wrapper for a service. And all logic should be in other classes. Also, we want this logic, of course, to be injected by interface. We don't want to have hard dependencies. So let's add logic here, logic classes. Yep. So. And also we want to inject it in constructor. Here. We want to have field. It's kind of classical. I like this naming, and we use underscore naming in our team. Once we have logic, we have everything there. So actually, it is quite easy. Actually, it's quite easy. Just pulls our surpatty. It is a method like here. So we have emulator and topology. Yeah, so we have response like here, lines and stations. We may have multiple lines. Now, for simplicity, I have only one stations and where the station is located and how long they are. Also, we need config. It's kind of our little pattern in our team, just to do everything in the same manner. So let's copy. Now we have topology config. It's just reads environment variable. It is one of the preferred methods for Service Fabric. So it is easy to have different installations of your Service Fabrics with this environment variables. Environment variables is actually from main project. Here we have a set of parameters for each environment, and in later in pipeline you just may set your, for example, dev node XML or stage XML or production XML, and you will have package configured with these variables. So, okay, we need to add this variable for configuration for our topology config, which is used in topology logic, and topology logic is using this URL to pull third-party service. So let's add this value in config. Actually, we need to add it in a few places. First of all, topology service in it package root service manifest should describe what variables it needs. So let's go to this package root and just add additional variable. It should be in section of code package. We just set it after after entering point nodes. Also, we need the same variable. We need to have this variable in application package root. Yeah, here. And also we need it in our local cluster definition. Here. Yeah, and also we need to have it in definition of service here. From first point of view, it may seem kind of tricky and maybe a lot of work for such simple thing. But from other side, you can redefine these variables, override these variables on each level you want. And on practice, it's worth of work. Yeah. We have this variable in all files. Now let's return to our topology service. We have it in config, and yep, we have it here. So as I talked before, to make dependency injection, we need some dependency injection system. Actually, it is quite easy for ASP.NET Core because we have amazing native dependency injection subsystem. From other side, we don't have it for microservices. And unfortunately, not all popular dependency injection frameworks has integration with Service Fabric. From other side, AutoFuck has it. It works quite well, and once you started with it in your parent class and service runner, you can use it in all services. So here we should implement it's our pattern. Now we should implement service runner, which will do all legwork for starting of service. As stateful service base do a lot of work for service itself, service runner is just to start service. So let's refactor this default code to use our, one moment, to use our runner. So what we need to do? We need to implement service runner. We do it inside this class because it's private, used only here, and nobody else should know about this. So also we need AutoFuck for Fabric. Yeah, AutoFuck for Service Fabric. Let's install it for topology service. Yep. Yeah, now we have it. Yes, our topology logic. Just add this default usins, and also now we can start our service quite easily and elegantly with the service runner and with dependency injection added here. One little step, we need to add special interface to our event source. To be compatible with our login system. Yeah, once it is here, it is resolved. Yeah. Also, we need Flur for our logic. Here now. Yeah, we need after fuck here as well. And also we need after fuck fabric here. One moment. Yeah, it was restored for some time. Now we have service command buildable. And okay. Yes, we have all solution buildable. So we have first of service ready. We have injected topology config and topology logic here. And from other side, we consume these injections in classical way in constructor and our methods of our service is just wrappers for some graphical problems my side. Yeah, just returned. Yes, and here we want just return data from our logic. So we want lines here. We can use personally. We need async task here. I like to get temporary variable for result that allows me to inspect what happens in this method instead of concise form when we just use. Use closure to return result. Yeah. Oh, actually, one moment. No. Yeah. It's implementation for list of lines in our topology, and this is implementation for list of stations per line. For example, we may have a huge topology, and we don't want to. We need a utility with some string functions to make our code shorter. So let's add existing project. It's our helper, so let's go to our repository. Yeah, helper's common. Okay, good. And add this as project reference to our topology service. So let's use it here. Yes, our topology is ready. So actually what we have implementation of this interface that will be, and we have in stateful service, we have actually inner loop. I like because I may have some things on background as and do it very fast because this loop is always running, and actually huge calculations, massive calculations can be performed here, pre-calculations on background. So actually system is getting faster. So we finish with topology service. Also we need, according to our diagram, we need two additional services, GPS position and train service. We want them to be added as service from the very beginning. We already have them, and we just need to refactor them a little bit to use our helpers. So we do it for topology service. We are going to do it for GPS position service. So just copy add dependencies to our service common. Yep. As well as for afterpack. We already have it here. Also, we can make our main much shorter this way. The same trick with event source. Now we have the same problem with dependency conflicts, actually. Not so big problem, but anyway, okay. Yes. Yeah, and we need we want some implementation of this GPS service that listens for, yeah, first of all, we need to inherit from our stateless from, sorry, not we don't have special helper. What's that here? Yep, it is train service, and we just need to implement it. First of all, we need to inject. Once we have injection system, we want to have here a remote service. Remote services is a set of clients. It's interface that have a set of properties for each service in this cluster. We discussed it in the beginning of the webinar. So now we just inject it here, and through it we have access to all other services. So we don't need these methods here. We just want to have service listeners. It creates endpoint for our remote listener. So this service may be addressed in our case from WebAPI side. Also, we need to implement this interface. We don't need run async because we are not going to do anything on background. We just need to return our service trains. Not on this one. Okay, we also need reference to our cluster models. Yeah, this is from my string helpers. Helpers common. I should do it here. Yes, we added, and also we need train, which is in cluster models subfolder. So we just need fusion. Okay, it seems to be done. And also we have our GPS service, which is GPS position service. Let's collapse this all. Yep. We need this little modification as we did for other services to make it inherit from our base stateful service. Okay. So alt known to request interface. Yeah, let's add this reference. Let's create runner. We just need this service runner. Yep, it is here. We need afterfuck here. I think we kind of have it. Yeah. Oh, sorry, not this one. Yeah, we want this one here. So each service has its own runner. Yeah, we don't have to register something additional here. So just leave it as is. Also, we need to add service runner for GPS. Yeah, we run server and need to modify service itself because now we inherit from our stateful service helper. We may have it simpler. From other side, we want to implement IGPS position service interface. Yeah, boss. We need boss reference. And we need our time source just to mark to have ability to unit test our classes and set desirable time. So let's implement field for it. Yep. Oh, sorry. Redundant brackets. Yeah, and let's make field. I just want to take down. Yeah, done. Now I want to implement this. Interface, I mean a GPS position service interface. Yeah, what we have here, we have two methods. Get train position async by line ID, and we have method receive train position async. According to our diagram, this is two role of the service. It listens for incoming GPS positions. From other side, it responds with this data to our stateless train service to marry GPS data with topology data and get set of station. So this is two functions of GPS service. Let's return. One moment, it's expected problems with version of, the problem is that actually wizard is built versus old version of Service Fabric SDK, and currently we have new version, but wizard is still not updated, and it is in contained by Visual Studio, so we need to do such routine modifications. One moment. I think we are almost done. Just service web API, and we may join it all together, and it will work. Yeah. So okay, let's build it. It's okay. So GPS is ready. GPS is ready, topology is ready. GPS topology train service is ready. We just need to modify web app interface to have all needed methods, and then we may start all system together. So let's go to our web app web service. Let's go to okay, we need additional controllers here, so let's do it kind of very fast because not too much time left. Yeah. Actually, we need three additional controllers. It's GPS position, which interacts with GPS. So, okay, we need cluster models here. Yeah. No, not this one. Oh, sorry. We need one more project. We need web models, which describes. Which describes our entries, that we, yeah, let's say that we share outside of our cluster and which is suitable for HTTP. So now add additional project with our one moment, it's topology, it's web models. Yeah, webinar models. One moment. Yep. And existing web models. Yep, this one. And we need dependency here. To web models. I think cluster models as well. Yeah, so also we need access to our service interfaces, of course. I would say to service common. And now it is here. Good. And we need a little bit to, first of all, to register dependencies we need. As I said before, we don't use AutoFAQ in ASP.NET Core projects because they have its own native, very good system, dependency system. So we will configure as it is usually done in ASP.NET Core. So we need time source here. We need course here because we are going to query our API outside of the of API domain. And any other browser will not allow us to do this. Like Google Chrome. And configuration for this one. Yep. Ready. So let's set our interfaces here. Yeah, it is done. Yeah, seems to work fine. Okay, now we have controllers ready, we have startup ready. Actually, everything we need. Let's build it all together. Yep. So let's try to start. Almost there. The only thing we'll need to do is to change. Okay, deployment succeeded. And we may verify it in Fabric Explorer. So you see that we have application here. One node, one application that is healthy without any warnings. And our cluster is trying to start. One moment. We have some issue. Okay, sorry. I forget about one. One little feature. We'll do it right now. For our runner, we should have all services not sealed and public, not internal. I forget about this feature, so I get this error. So So,
Dennis, I just I wanted to notify that we have 10 minutes before the end.
Okay, I think we'll be in time.
But also, participants, if you have some questions, just use the chat window and we'll have some time for answering them.
Yeah, but by the way, I can demonstrate how it works. I have built this project in our in another branch, so we can run it. Yep. So let's open this way. Okay, this is finished version of this. It's almost the same code, but finished and running. We can start it. Oh, I think we should maybe break our cluster first. So now we have errors in our services because of class modifiers. So okay, let's do it in this way. Let's reset our cluster. It will take maybe 2-3 minutes. Okay. Almost there. And we will see how our system, our fabric detects this station statuses. Yeah, seems it is almost done. Still a second. While resetting, we see errors here. Yeah, it is reset. Now we can start it. So we can see how it works in Dynamics on cluster management screen. We have no application here because I just resetted it and now application is being deployed to cluster from scratch. Yeah, one node, one application. Good. Some services is still loading. We can test it fast. One moment. I just controller by default that we don't need, but it says that our system is up and running. We may check. It is data from our service fabric. Seems our endpoints work well. Yeah. And you see that digits changing because emulator is working and pushing data to service fabric, and this data is preserved in reliable state. And we want output of our train service. Yeah, it works. So now we can view. One moment. So let's stop it a little bit. It is real world kind of model. And this one is so emulator on the left, emulator UI is a feed from emulator from additional method, and station monitor is filled from our from our fabric. So what we have, you see that trains are moving here. All stations are free, and now this train, first train is going to be, yep, in Stavanger. It left Stavanger. Yeah, and so everything in our system. Yeah, we can stop it a little bit. So everything is detected correct. We see our state of our stations and trains in it. And so our system is finished for this task. Now, if somebody have questions, you can ask. Or I can continue a little bit with my presentation and talk about some moments from there.
Yeah, I think it will. It's a good idea.
Okay, so I would like to talk a little bit about cluster design. They have nodes that you will see in Service Fabric management site. It have replicas. It's a set of some service. Even single node may have more than one replica, just for to be more reliable. So replicas can be switched very fast when it is loaded and actually running, just not accepting requests and waiting for its role to be primary. We discussed stateful and stateless microservices. We discussed supported frameworks. I mean, Net Core and Net Framework, classical Net Framework. I would like to maybe to talk a little bit about health checks. Actually, we have embedded system of health checks. It's kind of ping system to each service. So during any point of time, you have report about each node, each service, and so on. It's kind of nested report. So once some service on some node is don't respond, for example, in desired period of time, all node is considered is not considered healthy. So some actions should be taken. Also, this health check is extensively used during deployment. Deployment is incremental, so cluster is upgraded node by node. So once, for example, first node is upgraded and some service is switched to this node, to new version of itself, of the service. If health check fails, then deployment process detects it and may roll your application back in previous state, in previous version. Actually about deployment model, I just talked that it is incremental. You even may have groups of upgrade domain. For example, if you have a really big cluster, something like 7 or 9 machines in terms of Azure Service Fabric, it's a big cluster. You may set a few nodes, multiple nodes in groups, for example, 9 virtual machines in 3 groups, and they will, this upgrade domains, these groups will be updated simultaneously. So actually, if you, in our production, deployment takes about 30 minutes, maybe 40 minutes. And if you have 9 nodes in sequential manner, it will be half, maybe 2 hours. So you may group machines and do virtual machines and to upgrade them in. Also about popular mistakes. Don't buy too weak virtual machines for your fabric, because in case of the cheapest machines, Service Fabric potentially may run on them, but you may wait for, I don't know, 24 hours just this machine to be upgraded. So once you locate machine, it turns on and tries to upgrade itself. So if you have weak, cheap weak machine, it may not work at all. Don't use reliable collections as database, because there are huge problems when you have some when your version of your classes are not compatible backward and forward, it should be compatible in both directions. In other side, you will have broken, first of all, broken deployment, you will have broken data, and you will have you will spend a lot of time to just realize what is wrong. Of course, don't throw inception when constructing your services, because in other case, you will have this deployment, broken deployments. Once you have broken deployments, your data may be in inconsistent state, and you will end up with just losing this data and recreate it from very beginning. Of course, it will be a great problem for your client. Before you start with Service Fabric on Azure, you should ensure that you have access to your cluster virtual machines. In some cases, especially about reliable collection problems, you will not see error in any other source than event source of your virtual machine. For example, you just did refactoring in your system, and you didn't change collection data. You didn't add fields, you don't change fields, delete fields, and so on. But for example, you just change namespace. Once you change the namespace, it is a completely different type for net, and you will even not able to start to run your service with this new data. This namespace, and you will never get an idea what is wrong. But before you look in your into your virtual machine, yeah. So it is about what school you should buy. Actually, on practice, we know that. You should have the temporary storage is a crucial thing for your machine, and it must be more than 16 gigabytes. So consider this parameter very carefully. Yeah, about reliable collections, like I said, it is actually once you're not able to make it forward and backward compatibility, you should be ready to lose them. So you should not have since important data there, data that cannot be restored. You should consider them as just a very fast local cache that can be retrieved on another machine. So the main thing, reliable collection is not DB, is not database. Just fast cache, no more. Maybe in some system it is better to don't work with reliable collections and work with kind of just regular lists, dictionaries, and queues. I'm not going to talk about reliable collections anymore, because my teammate Vladimir will dive really deep in it in a week, as far as I remember.
It's so also worth mentioning that this presentation will be shared in our group public group, so in case you miss some slides, you'll be able to see it. Am I right?
Yeah.
We have some question.
Yeah, I see a question about application insights from Vladimir. So actually you just create application insight resource and you actually how we do it. We just create our client for application insights and just inject it on base service class level. Actually I can send you sample code from my production. I had no time to talk about this in this webinar because too small time.
And one more question.
You should use it when you have actually big project. It's not project for 1-2 months. And when it is critical to work without downtime, and it is critical to work 100% of time. So once you have good code, written code in your production, you will never be broken. So we run it for half a year in production now. We process at least half a million messages from railway system per day, and we have never been fucked up. From other side, if you have small project, if your client is not to pay significant money for hosting from other side, and is not going to pay, for example, for your learning curve, and of course you will have a lot of problems. It is not better not to start with Azure Service Fabric. So remember that your monthly bill may be only for hosting. You may be $5,000-$6,000 for 3 environments.
That's a lot.
Yeah, not my money, so I don't care. Money of client.
Good, so Denis, good work. We managed to do it in time. Thanks everyone for participating. Thanks, Denis, for such an interesting topic. As promised, we will share with you the video of this webinar in our group. Also, if you have any questions, Denis promised to answer them below this recording in our group again.
Yep.
Please leave your feedback. I sent you the link to the form in our chat. And follow our social media to get announcements about the new webinar soon. And as Denis announced, Volodymyr will have to talk about something in the nearest future.
Yeah, about reliable collections. Deep dive there.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, everyone. Have a good evening.